Alright, we're just going to get very quickly as possible, which usually when I say that still turns into an hour, but...
We've got a lot of filming to do today.
It is 9:30 in the morning. I'm wondering what it's going to be like when we're filming the last versus for today, what time it'll be, or the predictions video even. Alright, the first movie is something that was on your most anticipated list.
Yes.
Back when you didn't even know what its title was, you kept calling it Homeland.
Stupid television series!
You've been working. Has anybody else called it Homeland, or does everybody get it right?
Actually, I've been in concession, so I haven't been able to be in... Yeah, I know, it sucks.
There's always those fun mispronunciations, don't worry.
Maybe I'll... I got a shot tomorrow, possibly, of being there.
Alright, this is nothing like Homeland, by the way.
Thankfully not.
Yeah, I'm not a Homeland fan.
This is more like Breaking Bad.
Yeah, Franco actually made that joke on Conan. And there was, I think if you search the trailer on YouTube, the top comment right now is, previously on Breaking Bad.
Nice.
Okay, so, Homefront is written by Sylvester Stallone. It was something that he was going to, I think he had written it for himself, like, way back in the day. And then I just hit the lamp. He'd written it for himself way back in the day, but then I guess the project just didn't take off or something.
Yeah.
It's based on a book by a guy named Chuck Logan, who is not to be confused with Chuck Hogan, who wrote Prince of Thieves, which became The Town. That would mess with people, I guess, just to clear that up.
Potentially.
I didn't read the book, so I don't know how faithful Stallone was, but...
You didn't read a book? That's amazing.
Nowadays. There's a library right down here, and there's a library closer to where I live. It was at neither one of those. It was at one, like, all the way across town.
No need to go across town to get a book.
Yeah, I just gave up.
Exactly.
Just wait for the movie to come out.
And here it is.
So, Jason Statham is this DEA agent who's basically working undercover in the Expendables gang.
Yeah. Aces and eights.
And he's got the, what Will coined as the Shawn Michaels hair.
Yeah.
I love even later, Franco's like looking through a file and he sees it, and the first thing he says is, nice hair. But he's like, a lot of shit went down, and dude's got like gunned down, so he retired. I don't know if he retired just to retire, if he retired because of that. I don't remember if that was specified or not. But he decides he's going to, this might sound a little familiar, but I'll get to that in a second. Basically, he decides he's going to go full-on American, even though Jason Statham's British. And he's going to take his daughter, and they're going to live in this little backwoods area. Where there's the mom is dead, by the way.
Correct.
As I'm sure you figured, anyway. And they're just going to live a peaceful life and be happy. But his little girl has basically been raised by him, because the mother's dead. So she is basically... learn to defend herself by kicking ass on the playground, literally. So there's this fat kid that looks like one of the O'Doyles.
Yeah, does.
Who's like torturing her on the playground. So she beats his ass. But it turns out that that kid's mom is Kate Bosworth.
Mm-hmm.
And Kate Bosworth throws a holy shit. She's fucking trailer trash, of course. Because this is like fucking Louisiana or something. I don't think that... Did they specify where exactly they were?
I don't recall.
I seriously wouldn't be surprised if it was Louisiana. So, she throws a holy shit fit and they leave the school and she's talking to her deadbeat... Is that even her husband or was that just a boyfriend? I think it was her husband.
I think it's her husband.
And she says, I'm going to tell my brother about this. I'm going to make my brother take care of this. Turns out, her brother is a crystal meth cook... named Gator.
Yes.
Played by James Franco. Doing a much... Does anybody... Do you remember Crystal Clear from The Green Hornet?
Yeah.
The meth dealer he played?
Of course I do.
This guy is basically... backwoods Crystal Clear. And so... the plot goes from there. Basically, they decide they're going to torture him. Here's what happens. Do you remember the Steven Seagal movie Fire Down Below?
Vaguely.
That's what this movie turns into, basically. But it's a good version of it. Fire Down Below is not very good. But I actually like Homefront.
It's good.
And once again, the people who came here for a very straightforward review, that's all they needed, and they're on to the next
Bye.
One. So, basically, this town turns into Cheers, and everybody knows his name.
Yep.
Like, every single person he comes into contact with knows who he is.
But not in a good way.
Yeah, and wants to basically threaten and kill him.
Yeah.
Particularly the scene at the gas station. Where he, and this, the, I don't know if it was the sound in the theater, if this is the, what it is for the movie, but these, like, the violence isn't that bloody.
No.
The violence is the main reason it's rated R. I mean, there is blood in it. But, most of the really strong violence comes from, just the beatings he gives people. Like, the sound effects are really brutal when he hits somebody.
The language is pretty harsh, too. So, I mean,
the language is nonstop, but that's beside the point.
It's also a reason to rate something R.
I think Franco by himself said about as many fucks as there are in The Departed. Like, I don't complain about this. I think it's funny. I mean, in the right context, I think it's funny. So, profanity can also be used to try too hard, but
yep.
Here I thought it worked. Because it was, believe it or not, it was kind of added to his character, because that's just the way he was. Because he was angry all the time.
Yes.
That's why. When somebody's angry all the time, then they can do it and it's funny.
Of course.
See thousands of viral videos, probably. One problem that kind of, I mean, I wouldn't, it wasn't really, well, here's the thing. I don't know if I just got used to it or if they didn't do it the whole time, but mainly the action scene at the beginning.
Yeah.
You know, I hate to, you know, I feel bad criticizing someone who still hasn't been dead very long. But the action scenes in this movie went to the Tony Scott school of zoom in, zoom out, zoom in, zoom out. like I said, I can't remember if the whole movie was like that, or maybe it was and I just got used to it, but it was really distracting.
It was there, and it was very prevalent in different parts of the movie.
Really, especially in that opening scene. The action scenes are still fine, though.
Yeah.
Like, there's this, there's another particular scene that stands out where they're, I think he's in the meth lab at this point, and they've caught him, and they have him tied up, and he actually has his hands tied behind his back, and it's kind of like, it's not necessarily like the Drew Barrymore scene in Charlie's Angels, but it's the same setup. He manages to kick all their asses with his hands tied behind his back.
Like Jason Statham would do in any movie.
Yeah, I think Crank did that too.
Yeah, I believe so, actually.
But yeah, let's go into the cast now, I guess.
All right.
I was getting ready to say something there and then I lost it. Franco's girlfriend is played by Winona Ryder.
Yes.
Who is this trashy, all the characters in the movie are trashy except for Jason Statham and his daughter, by the way. And the sheriff that's played by Clancy Brown.
Yes.
The ever-amazing Clancy Brown. Mr. Krabs himself. and he's, shit, I keep losing what I was going to fucking say. It's early.
It's very early. It'll be interesting what happens when we're later in the day.
Okay. So we have Kate. I've never been a fan of Kate Bosworth, but she actually played this part fairly well. it's definitely a far stretch from Blue Crush, which I think was the first place I saw her.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I didn't see The Horse Whisperer until later. Horse Whisperer is when she was like 10 and went by Catherine Bosworth. But Frank Grillo, who is everywhere. I think Grillo is how you say it. I feel like somebody's gonna tell me it's Grillo or something. but he doesn't. I'm pretty sure it's probably just Grillo, but. That dude is fucking everywhere.
Yeah.
Like, he's one of those guys where I keep seeing his name in credits, but I don't really think about him, and I can't really point him out when he shows up. He was the, there's this subplot where there are, the opening scene, the dude, this is all just coming back to me, I almost forgot the rest of this movie before we rolled, the dude that was killed in the beginning with the biker gang.
Yeah.
There is, like, the head biker dude. And he's in prison now after that shakedown, if you will.
Yeah.
So he's pissed off and he wants to kill Jason Statham. So Franco and Winona Ryder figure out who Statham is by breaking into his house and stealing his kid's toys for some reasons.
And her cat.
Yes. Her stuffed rabbit and her cat.
Yes.
He doesn't kill the cat, though. He kills the rabbit. He cuts its head off and hangs it in the woods somewhere.
If I had to choose, I would definitely want the rabbit killed instead of the cat.
Forget it. It still had the cotton sticking out of its neck and everything. But anyway, so they inform this guy that they know where Statham is. Because Franco wants to become... Franco thinks it'll help distribution.
Of course.
This guy will help him distribute shit everywhere. His drug.
Because he's got a lot of connections, obviously.
So they agree to hand Statham over to the rest of the biker gang, which is, I guess, Grillo is basically their little leader now.
Of course.
And the ending of this movie turns into the end of Mud, which is
weird. I noticed that, too. I was like, this is going to Mud territory. Especially the very ending of the movie.
Only it's a lot more violent.
Yes.
We also had a cameo. I don't know. I wouldn't call it a cameo because he's just one of those guys that's just in there and nobody really knows who he is. Prue Taylor Vance played the middleman in this. Mm. Who is the big bald guy that you've seen in a lot of stuff. So many things I can't even think. Identity. He was the one who said they were all inside.
Yeah.
Among many, many... You go to his IMDb page, there's probably 600 movies on it. Which is really great because he's in JFK. And the fact that... he's in JFK and he's in Trapped. Which makes Pruitt Taylor Vance the go-to person for me when I'm playing the Kevin Bacon game. Because that guy's in fucking everything. And he's been in two movies with Kevin Bacon.
Nice!
Yeah, look at his IMDb page and then try playing the Kevin Bacon game. You'll beat the shit out of everybody. So, I can see where people probably won't like this movie, because it pretty much is, it is very plain in the genre, but there's still something I like. I think it's the involvement of Franco.
Yeah.
Because Franco is very interesting, because he's one of those people that will pretty much take part in anything just to have the experience of it. So you see him in all these prestige projects, and you see him, when he got an Oscar nomination for 127 Hours, and you see him in the Seth Rogen comedies, and you see him doing pretentious shit like As I Lay Dying. I'm not calling As I Lay Dying pretentious, I'm calling the movie he made. Because, the whole movie of As I Lay Dying is told in, split screen, and it's fun. But, and then to see him just take part as this... hardcore villain in a Jason Statham movie within all of this other stuff. It's
the same year he played Oz.
Yeah, and Alien. But he was talking on Conan about playing this character in Alien in the same year and how they're both drug dealers. I don't remember Alien specifically being a drug dealer. I thought he was mainly in weapons, but did we ever actually see him do what he does? I
don't... We saw the weapons. We never saw the drugs.
But did we ever see Alien actually do business?
No, he was too dumb to do business.
We just saw him hanging out.
He just chilled out with the girls.
I guess technically his scenes with Archie were business.
Yeah, definitely.
We've gone from Homefront and we derailed into Spring Breakers.
Because we love that movie so much.
But yeah, it's worth seeing. I don't think it's going to have much of an audience because it just looks so... It just looks so normal. There really isn't anything special about it. But there's just... Oh! I missed something. There's a very interesting...
Right on.
Well, I just figured this was worth mentioning just because it's weird. The introduction of Winona Ryder. I just thought this scene was worth talking about. I don't really have a point for bringing it up. I just want to bring it up.
Alright, fair enough.
So Gator's hanging out in his garage, which is his, cover. And Winona Ryder comes in, and they're doing their little thing, hey, guess what, our characters know each other. And then he leans in and kisses her, and we just cut right from that kiss to him fucking her on this car. And then the scene lasts for 2 seconds, and then we just cut, and then they're just having a conversation. It's almost like the scene never happened.
That scene happened in his mind. He is on a lot of, he could be on a lot of his drugs too.
Yeah, he does do his own drugs, and he supplies for his sister when she's like all needy. Yeah, there's kind of a subplot involving Kate Bosworth's husband, who's like, that's who Statham thinks is doing everything before he gets to know Gator.
Yeah.
So, by the way, they call him, his name is Morgan. They call him Gator because he has a gator tattooed on his forearm. There's probably another story behind that, but the only backstory we get on is the tattoo.
That's a backwoods backstory right there, folks.
Yeah, it's not like Samuel Jackson in Jungle Fever, whose character's real name was Gator. So, that's pretty much Homefront. I mean, it really isn't anything special, but, you know, it's entertaining enough to where I would... If you asked me if you should go see it, I'd say, yeah, go.
It'll bring out the Statham fans.
So,
it was good. I enjoyed it.
Yeah. I mean, it wasn't like the... When I heard that Franco was going to be the villain in a Statham movie, I maybe expected something a little more awesome, but it's still, you know, probably fine. Like, it's much better than Fire Down Below, which it will remind you of for sure, but I don't recall a Deliverance reference.
No.
That's impressive.
Normally, when you have a backwoods town, you always have something like that.
Well, let's remember, not many people tend to think about this or care to think about this, but it's absolutely true, and people need to come to terms with it. Sylvester Stallone is an Oscar-nominated screenwriter.
Yeah?
Sylvester Stallone wrote a movie that won Best Picture.
Yeah. Segway.
Just so you know. So when you see written by Sylvester Stallone, that shit's got prestige on it that you don't know about.
Exactly.
So yeah. This would have made a very... I would have liked to have seen this as a Stallone movie. I love Statham. Because Statham's got this... I've mentioned this a couple times, but I'll go ahead and mention it again. I mentioned it in the Parker review, I think. Statham tends to make the same movie over and over and over again.
Yeah.
Redemption, I brought this up too. But Statham just has this...
Presence?
He's got a charisma, mm-hmm. and he's got a self-awareness that pretty much... helps him rise above a movie, no matter how ridiculous it is. The only movie he was in that was never, ever, ever going to be saved because of how much of a terrible piece of dog shit it was Crank 2.
Crank 2 is terrible.
But, other than Crank 2, Jason Statham has enough of a charisma and self-awareness that he can bring something worth watching to a movie that may not be worth watching.
Agreed.
But, now, as I was saying, though, I would have loved to have seen this as a Stallone movie. I'm not sure what period of Stallone this was, but when he was trying to get this made the first time, but it would have been interesting.
Definitely. Because
I'm a big Stallone fan, especially, make sure, I'm going to go ahead and take this time right now to say, go check out Bullet to the Head if you haven't yet.
Knew that was coming.
Yeah. So, okay. Our next movie might be a little, I wouldn't say controversial, but you may not want to listen to me.
I know this. I knew this was coming. I could tell by the way you were dealing with things. I knew this was coming.
Hold on. Okay. This review is complicated.
Oh, boy.
A movie with a little snowman that walks around like this named Olaf. Is one where I say, this review is complex.
Yeah.
Okay. There is a big difference between my opinion of these movies and everybody else.
Correct.
Judging by its box office, most of you have probably already seen Frozen.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm just going to put this out there right now. People are talking up Frozen like it's the best thing since the beginning of time. I actually saw a review... that word for word said the best animated movie since Beauty and the Beast.
I wouldn't go that far.
Yeah, that shuns The Lion King when you say that.
And the fact that Toy Story 3 was nominated for the Oscar and up. And
that was in an extended category, though, so...
But still, it did have that prestige.
So, I'm gonna tell you... Just, okay... Well, it's impossible to hate this movie, so I can't say that. And I don't even dislike it. I like it. Okay? There are other movies that I hate, but here's, and I'm going to tell you that right now. The reason I didn't have faith in this movie right away is because I hate Tangled.
Yes.
And everybody loves Tangled. But, and I thought it looked a lot like Tangled from the trailer. I figured it would have that same feel, and that is that a moose or a reindeer? They said it was a reindeer.
It was a reindeer, and
he looks like a fucking moose, but...
Yeah.
He basically looked like he would be exactly the horse from Tangled.
Yep.
Like a carbon copy.
Even the face was the same.
So, here's the thing. I'm not gonna try and disenchant anybody that loved this. Because I can see why. Because it's, you know... Okay. Now that I've pretty much told you for everything from everybody else's perspective, I'm gonna say mine.
Oh boy.
I don't hate this movie at all. I would recommend it. I'm just saying... There's a few things that bothered me. Here's the thing, though. I hate to say this, but... These kind of animated movies are something that the industry probably needs, but I don't like them.
Okay.
You have Tangled, which was 2010. And you had Brave, which was last year. I think Tangled and Brave blow. But at the same time, they are this... They manage to bring back the feel, I guess, of the classical Disney movies.
Exactly.
Without the hand-drawn animation. I think the Tangled Frozen animation is weird. I think it looks off. It's kind of like when, I'm not going to say straight to DVD or anything, but the animation looks, okay, let me specify. I'm mainly talking about characters.
Mm-hmm.
Because this kind of animation, like, the animation in Frozen, like, the landscapes and shit are, like, insane.
Exactly.
But the people are...
You don't like their characters.
They look like they came out of a straight-to-DVD animated movie. Like, there's little spin-off DVDs that come with movies. Another problem is... I hate saying this because it makes me sound like one of those people where it's like, ooh, fuck happiness. But I'm not like that. However, I think these movies suffer from a massive overly cutesiness. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I can see what you're talking about.
Let's talk about this character. I've forgotten her name already.
You're referring to Anna?
Yes.
Okay.
She's the younger sister of the older sister, whose name I've also forgotten.
Elsa.
And she's the annoying little sister. The bouncy one. And the problem that I noticed especially, because we were in a very... It's not so much that we were in a full theater, it's that we were in a small theater with a lot of people in it.
I agree with that.
Who are all loving this shit, by the way.
Yes.
But here's the problem. I love Kristen Bell, by the way. And she, when she grew up, it was Kristen Bell. But I'm still talking about the little one first. The younger one, I mean. I should have, like, practiced this review or something, because I'm trying to make two different points at the same time, and I'm all over the fucking place.
It's all right. Now I'm done.
I think there's this, I don't know if it's just today or if it's always been and I just didn't notice it because it's starting to wear thin on me or something, but it seems like nowadays when you have a jumpy, constantly happy protagonist, people tend to take hyper and annoying and think that it's charming. I suppose hyper and annoying can be charming.
Yes, it can.
But this character was like clawing at my brain from inside, and I couldn't get it out. And it's just okay. Let me continue. This beginning goes really, really fast.
Yeah.
And this, okay. I know this probably seems nitpicky, but just give me a break. So, what exactly is her deal?
It's never really decided what it is.
Alright, she can just turn shit into ice.
She has powers from when she was a little baby, and we'd never really find out exactly why.
Because.
That's exactly why, it's because.
So she can, like, do this, and there's, like, an ice hill, and there's, like, over here, and then everything is, like, you know, covered and frozen and ice and all that, and everything looks like this mystical icy wonderland.
Yes.
And then she's making these little mountains, and the annoying sister is hopping and hopping, and then there's not a mountain there! So she... I guess there's an atomic snowball at her or something to stop her from dying. It didn't look like a long fall at all. I don't know why she resorted to, like, stopping her heart to keep her from falling.
She doesn't know her own powers, is what it is.
Okay. But anyway, this all happens so fast.
Yeah.
And then suddenly, and this traumatizes her too, she gets the rogue streak from X-Men. And then they're like, oh god, we gotta make sure... They really, really, really react to this. It's like, she can never fucking know this shit ever happened.
Lock her in a tower immediately.
Erase her memory while we're at it.
Will Smith, where are you now?
And then they lock her away from everything so she can just make ice shit by herself in a locked room. All because of this little fall that traumatized her, apparently.
And also, it actually wiped the memory of the little sister. It wiped Anna's memory so she could never know that she has powers.
Okay. I don't know why that's such a massive... I mean, I know the whole... Okay. If the little sister had been killed in this incident, I can see, oh shit, nobody can know about this, lock her away now. But this seemed like a minor accident.
They knew what her full potential could be, and that's the reason why they were trying to keep her safe.
And then we go into Disney melodrama where, shock surprise, the parents die. Because is there a Disney character that has a full set of parents?
Not that I could think of off the top of my head.
Okay. So, then we get this, you know...
Full set, no.
Okay, here's the thing, though. Once again, I hate to be that person that's all, you know, ooh, fuck people that have emotions. But this... Okay. So we have... There's so many. We'll start with The Lion King, because I think that's where this got popular. One of the big deals about The Lion King is how fucking dramatic it is for being a kids' movie by Disney.
Yeah.
It's got, you know, it's Hamlet. It's got family members murdering each other for power, and it's got people starving and people imprisonment and people getting ripped apart and the hyenas being turned into Nazis.
Lion King's amazing.
And since then, especially with fucking Pixar, it's basically been the end thing for Disney to be as dramatic as possible. And sometimes I think sometimes Disney knows its reputation for being, like, really deep in the emotions and, like, being really shocking about things you wouldn't see in kids' movies because they're so dark. And I think they're trying too hard with that now. Because they tried to do this big, dramatic thing when the parents die, you know, because it was so shocking when the parents died in a Disney movie. And we see their big, tragic funeral and everybody's all sad and shit. By the way, one thing also, this is just a nitpick, but...
This is your review.
As the girls are getting older, time is just progressing. Like, There's no... It doesn't say the time has progressed. We just see time progress because we see them getting older.
Mm.
This has been happening for a while now in the opening.
Or would you like to build a snowman opening?
But then finally... after all this time has passed and we've seen them grow up enough, then there's this tiny little passage of time where it actually says 3 years later. Why start fucking telling us that now?
Yeah.
Sorry, that's just
a big nitpick.
I just saw it and I was like, this is not useful information because you've been seamlessly passing through time as it was without saying anything, and now you want to tell us, I guess. Okay. So anyway, it gets a little better when we are introduced to what's probably going to go down as one of the iconic Disney sidekicks.
Mm-hmm.
Disney sidekicks can go one way or the other. Either they're great and become iconic and everybody loves them, or they're annoying pieces of shit that you just want to go away and die.
You really don't like Mushu, do you?
Mushu's fine.
You seem like the type that wouldn't like Mushu.
No, he's fine.
Okay, good, just making sure.
I particularly like that scene where, nobody probably remembers this scene, because it's a line that is not even, you're not even supposed to pay attention to this line, but it was just funny to me. We're going into that now that you brought it up. Just this scene where they're running, and I can't even remember what it was now. I've only seen the movie once, but the thing is running behind him, and he just turns around, and he's like, he says something like, hey, where are you going, or something like that. Like, he doesn't want to be followed.
Yeah.
I don't know why, but that just fucking killed me. And that's a nothing line that's not even supposed to have a reaction.
Nice.
Because the scene just fades out after he says that. But anyway, here we have Olaf, who is the snowman. Voiced by the devil himself, and we're not even going to talk about that.
Yeah.
No, I think Olaf's going to be one of the more beloved ones.
He already has. He's got merch everywhere in the parks right now.
Yeah. Because I love that first trailer we got that was just him and the ice and losing his nose.
Yes.
That was just a trailer by itself. That whole thing. And I think he brings a lot of... Like I said, it's... If this character had been done the wrong way, he probably would have been the next Jar Jar Binks.
Yeah.
But he's Olaf is basically a snowman version of what I think Jar Jar Binks was supposed to be if they wanted to make him a good character.
Interesting.
Because he's comedy relief that's actually funny, and he's inept without being, like, overdoing it. And he's able to be, like... There's a couple of sad moments where you think he might be ill-fated.
Yeah.
Because naturally he's a snowman, and obviously snowmen can't be around all the time. So there's kind of that foreboding something is probably going to happen to him. But even when that's, like, happening, most people have seen Frozen anyway, so I don't necessarily have to say whether they have a solution to this.
I like that solution, though. That was pretty awesome.
But he's happy all the time when this is happening, because I can't remember the exact line, but it's something along the lines of, he's very happy about something, and he's starting to melt. And his line is something along the lines of, this is the greatest day of my life, and it might also be my last! And he says this as he's melting.
See, the last great Disney that could have been iconic and that would have pushed it farther, sidekick, right, would be Doug. From Up.
Oh, yeah.
That's the same kind of character that Olaf is to me.
I prefer Ray from Princess and the Frog that same year.
Ray works as well, but I mean,
Yeah, that's the, and that's another interesting thing about Disney trying really hard to be dark. I will say, I'm kind of glad that Olaf finishes the movie where he finishes it.
Yeah.
Because that would have been, you know, a bummer.
Just like Ray.
Even though I say a lot of times I do try hard to be dark, that was really fucking ballsy to kill Ray.
No lie.
I really didn't see that shit coming.
No.
Which was one of the saddest scenes of, like, the last 10 years, so we won't go into that to spare our own emotions. Okay, here's a problem. The modern dialogue.
Yeah.
There were a few moments, but one stands out. I know this word has been around for a while, but the way it's used in the modern context now drives me up the fucking
wall.
I was going to say drives me fucking insane. I was going to say drives me up the fucking wall. I almost just said drives me fucking up insane.
Just pause it right before or after you said up insane. It would have been funny.
When, okay, obviously, the main character has to have a love interest.
Yes.
Who's this fuck, this dumbass.
Yeah.
Of course. And when they meet, she says something about the situation being awkward.
Mm.
But she says awkward in the modern way. If you have any idea what I mean by that. It's shit like that. It's not always there, but it's like, it's sprinkled in there. And that just, number one, it's annoying, and number two, it doesn't fit the setting. And it's just this thing for it to be, everybody wants to be Shrek. Everybody wants to be fucking hip. So, you know.
The original Shrek's the only one that did it right.
Okay, so, Shrek 2's on par with it.
Yeah, it's alright.
I'm one of the only people that likes the fourth one a lot. Okay. We're getting close to the end of the movie. And, not the review, sorry. People that like to complain. there's this... What is it? There's maybe 20 minutes left. And for no fucking reason at all, we suddenly have a villain.
Yeah.
What the fuck was that for?
Did you hear the gasp in the theater when the heel turn was going down?
There was really no reason for it. I mean, he had his little reasons and everything, but I mean, the story could have not gone in that direction and made perfect sense. Couldn't it?
Yeah, because everything could have went off with Kristoff and everything would have been fine.
They had to make it... That's the thing now, though, is anime news used to be really, really short. Like, 80 minutes, if that. Sometimes 75 minutes.
Now we're pushing 2 hours every single time.
Yeah.
If not longer.
The fucking Incredibles started that, I think.
There's nothing wrong with the Incredibles.
Except its length. So, anyway, I really did not... I can understand if they wanted to do that, but why so last minute? That makes it seem very tacked on and pointless.
Maybe.
You know, because it was tacked on and pointless. But I mean, with the story and everything going on, it had like this massive potential that apparently everybody in the world except for me thought it reached.
I think the 3D is incredible.
But, yeah, I guess we should talk about the short.
Yes.
Apparently, everybody loves the short.
So awesome.
What's it called? Like, Get Off My Horse or something?
Yeah.
It's something like that. Or Get Your Own Horse or something.
It's an old short from the 30s, actually, that they modernized for this movie.
And
it works really well.
Obviously, it's in the, you kind of expect something's gonna happen, because it's like, when it's the black and white, it's in like a smaller aspect ratio, but you can see that there's like...
Something around it.
Yeah. And of course, they do the Last Action Hero thing, and they actually break out. But the thing is when it's in black and white and in the original aspect ratio, it's 2D.
Mm-hmm.
But then when they break out of the screen, they're in color, and it's in 3D.
Yep.
And they have a wider area to work in. And they keep going back and forth and in and out, and it's a very, clever concept.
I like it a lot.
So, it's certainly better and more creative than the Blue Umbrella.
I love the Blue Umbrella.
Yeah, it's fine. It's just, this is a lot more creative.
Agreed.
It's not just your normal, hey, we're Pixar, let's make inanimate objects. Animated objects, oh, they're all fucking animated, but I mean, inanimate objects be real shit. And fall in love and all that bullshit. So, that's pretty much it. I think it's just okay. I also love the, Olaf gets his song about summer.
Yes.
And he's basically, he's talking about how great summer is, and even though all the clues are around him, especially in the song, he's not coming to terms with the fact that he'll melt in summer. like he, I can't remember what the lyric is now, but he starts to build up a lyric that's gonna rhyme with puddle. And he says he's gonna be, and he actually looks down at a puddle. but then he says something else.
Yeah.
And doesn't even acknowledge it. So, yes, I said you've probably already seen this, and if you haven't already seen it, I'm sure it's been thoroughly recommended to you, which makes this totally pointless. So
that's where I come in, obviously.
So that's pretty much...
Real quick, you brought up... Obviously, you brought up Tangled, and you don't like Tangled. I understand that, and it's always my go-to when I bring up the fact... In all the review videos, it's always like I bring up Tangled because I know what you don't like.
And Brave.
And Brave, yeah, exactly. I will say right now that...
I'm about to be called sexist for sure.
There is a... it's potential. There is a... Just a split second. And I thought I caught it, but I wasn't positive. And then there was a screen cap that was posted on Twitter. And for a split second, I don't know if you even saw this. When they open up... You know how there's little PSs to every single Pixar movie and most Pixar movies? Well, Disney's doing this now, too. And... When they open up the gates for the first time, and you see Anna run out the door when it opens up, in the foreground, you have Rapunzel and Eugene for a split second standing there, and it's unmistakable that it's them. So I thought that was kind of cool. I will say right now that you've got your first big candidate for Best Original Song at the Oscars this year. I almost guarantee, I can imagine... Both Kristen Bell and Idina Menzel singing to each other on stage at the Oscars this coming year. I almost guarantee it's going to happen. I don't know how many nominees there's going to be this year, because obviously we've had this deal where there's been like three lately, and we don't know if there's going to be five or four.
There was five last year, I think.
Yeah, but it seems like every couple of years there's one that we only have like three nominations, so it's kind of like... Remember it was Slumdog versus the World? So.
Slumdog versus Wall-E.
Yep. Exactly.
And then the Muppets versus Rio.
And Peter Gabriel wouldn't even perform his own songs. He got John Legend to do it for him. I think this is going to be a great iconic Disney song. I like a lot of the music in the movie. I think it fits very well. And it's funny because I was looking around during the musical numbers, and there were some of the parents that were like, I didn't know this is going to be a musical. And he got up, and I remember he was walking away, and I was like, well, you're not... walking your kid to the bathroom, you're getting away because you don't want to see the musical. But yeah, this movie is just, it looks incredible, and 3D is really utilized to the fullest of its extent. And if you have a choice of going to regular or 3D, go to 3D, honestly, because it actually works really well. So. You at least can agree that 3D does work in this movie. Makes it pop a lot better, the imagery.
Our last movie is one that you don't have an opinion on.
I have maybe a 15-minute opinion on it.
This movie is 2 hours and 10 minutes, and you were asleep for an hour 45?
No, not that long. Hour 15.
I'm pretty sure it was long.
I don't know, because I don't remember seeing much of this movie. I was really tired.
Our last movie for this video is The Book Thief, which is that movie you might have... Let me talk about the trailer first. I thought this was hilarious, and I guess some other people called it out too. This trailer made this movie look really, really triumphant.
Yeah.
But here's what happened. Because you see all these comments about how it's a masterpiece flashing on the screen.
A lot of people were talking Oscar for it and everything.
Well, if you really look at the trailer, here's what it says. Okay, let's think back to Don John.
Okay.
Don John went to Sundance many months before the trailer came out.
Correct.
So, they took comments that critics said about Don John when it played at Sundance and put them in the trailer.
Of course.
Like, you know, it's original, it's hilarious, it's heartwarming. Those were critics talking about Don John.
Yes.
Because they saw it at Sundance.
Correct.
When you watch the Book Thief's trailer, it says, based off the best-selling novel, The Book Thief, which was hailed as, and then all these magnificent comments start to take up the screen that are talking about the book, not the movie itself.
That's false advertising right there.
And it says, like, from the studio that brought you Life of Pi. You do realize Let's take a look at this. Okay, what's a big, let's see, what's something big universal? Okay, Universal did Savages. This is what they mean. Universal did Savages.
Yes.
Universal has done many movies.
Yes.
Think about this. The Savages trailer. You have Benicio with the skull mask. You got Aaron Johnson fucking Blake Lively in the bathtub. You got the drugs. You got Selma Hayek saying, I'm going to cut their throats. You could actually say an Oliver Stone film, Savages, from the studio that brought you Beethoven and Billy Madison.
I was going E.T. and Back to the Future, but you went a little bit more obscure than mine.
That's how vague from the studio that brought you is, just so you're aware. Because most people don't really even think about that. Like, it's really not necessary to put it out there.
Nah.
Because, like... Okay. When Paul Greengrass did the Bourne Supremacy, and then he did the Bourne Ultimatum, the Bourne Ultimatum's fucking trailer said from the director of the Bourne Supremacy.
That's great.
Oh, okay. It's not as bad as when they used from the director of Ito Mamatambi and Harry Potter and the Prisoner of Azkaban in Children of Men's trailer. Because all three of those movies are so fucking different.
And nobody would watch any of those three that's in the theater except maybe like three people.
Okay, so let's actually talk about The Book Thief now. that was just fun to talk about.
Yes, it was.
All right. This is one of those... It's basically a coming-of-age movie in Germany. And you can very much tell it's based off a best-selling book. You can just... Like, even if you didn't know, those movies you can fucking point out.
Mm-hmm.
With that blindly. Okay, so... There's this mother who has this... I know nothing about the book. I literally knew nothing of what this was going in. Because the trailer didn't even tell me anything.
No.
You have this girl and you have this son. And they're with their mother on this train. And they're going to live with these new parents. I think that was, maybe it was, I don't know. But anyway, in this really fucking weird twist of fate, the boy just dies on the way there. Like, he's just dead. So they go and they take them, and the new parents are Jeffrey Rush and Emily Watson. Who are completely opposites. Because Jeffrey Rush is the really soft soul, and he's like, hey, and, you know, like, I will help you out of the car and all that. I am Jeffrey Rush, I am charming. Don't you know that? unless you watch House on Haunted Hill or something.
Yes.
or Pirates. But, Emily Watson is this hardcore, I won't say evil, but well, here's the thing. You have two kids on this train that are supposed to be delivered to them. And the boy just died. The boy was younger than the girl, I think. And the kid is dead. They had to stop the train and just fucking bury them where they were. Emily Watson is pissed because she was supposed to have two children. She does not give a fuck that he died. She just knew that she was supposed to have two children and she's pissed off.
You replace him now.
So she just... is pissy and resentful and takes the daughter. I think she's going to be pissy and resentful regardless because that's just her character. So then you have a bunch of plots now. You have the little boy that likes her. And they have a thing. Then you have, there's this bully at school. Then she and Jeffrey Rush can't read and they're trying to teach each other how to read. Then they take in this guy that they're hiding, who has this book. And this is all going on about the same time. Plus, on top of all the war shit in the background, mm-hmm. all that comes into play in and out. This is the vaguest description you're probably going to get, because that's all I can give you. Okay. So, I would like to talk a few things about... I will talk about how it looks. It does have a, it has an elegance to its appearance.
Mm.
Especially that opening shot with, like, all the snow and shit. And the train. Like, that's, I've always loved that. That's, if you want a really, really good shot in a movie, you've got a good chance to use snow. I fucking love snowy shopping movies. And there's a lot of them in this. And, you know, just this production design through the whole thing is very, you know, you always feel like you're there.
Which got a lot of Hugo in it, too.
Yeah, it's not like like Romeo and Juliet recently, where there were some really great authentic sets, and then other sets looked like rejected school play sets that were just kind of sitting on a soundstage or something.
Yeah.
But no, all of this looks totally, completely authentic. Also, they do this, because of all the white and all the snow, they have the, this actually isn't that common. They have the subtitles in black boxes, so you can read them. So, if you watch the fucking French Connection, good God. When the villains are talking, they're in a really, really bright place, and the subtitles are white, and you literally cannot fucking read them. Nobody, that movie is this prestigious Oscar-winning Best Picture winner. They didn't bother to make the subtitles legible.
Why was that?
But no, this movie actually, puts, a black bar. It's a little off-putting at first, because you don't see it very often, but you're like, well, I guess that's helpful, because, you know, you can't really read them otherwise. Like, yellow's hard on the eyes, and if you try black on the white, there's always going to be something black there that blocks a word or something. Slumdog kind of took that approach, too. There is, but for the most part, the movie is, it's got a good first 45 minutes or so. That sets the tone and sets up these characters, and it's got a charm about it. Especially the Jeffrey Rush is really, really good. And I would say Emily Watson is good, but I'm not much of a fan of her, so I can never really tell when she's good and when she's not, because I'm not a fan of her in general.
Really. Mm-hmm.
There's nothing, I haven't seen Breaking the Waves yet before anybody mentions that, but, just like in Punch Drunk Love or something, I just think she never really leaves much of an impression, to me anyway. She's got a lot of fans, though. After a while, though, especially when, they started housing the guy, it got, less engrossing and dull and lifeless. It just kind of went. But there is a horrible... Okay, I'm not sure which one of these things I should talk about first. I will talk about when it gets to the end. There's something very interesting about the ending, but it's a little undermined by another problem. I got really mad at David Fincher when he made The Curious Case of Benjamin Button.
Mm-hmm.
Because that movie is so fucking long.
Yes.
And there is one scene towards the end that fades out. But then, of course, you know, we go back and there's the next scene. I was really irate when I first saw that movie because I said time and time and time again, if you have, like I said, I'm not one of those people that absolutely wants to get up as fast as I can. I'm just saying it really affects your pacing if you make people think your movie's ended when it isn't. Looking back on it, that probably wouldn't have been a good ending to Benjamin Button if it ended on the fade out. But here's the thing. If you're making a movie that long and you're going to fade out on a scene that's close to the end but isn't the end, maybe you should use another transition.
It's like the Two Towers.
Because that fade out, I think the fade out is very finalized.
Yeah.
Like, unless your movie is told in parts or if it's ending, it's when you should use a fade out.
True.
This movie, for the record, is 40 minutes shorter than Benjamin Button. or a half an hour, probably. Pretty much there's maybe five scenes building up to the end. Yeah. But after every single one of these scenes, there's a fade out.
Yeah.
Don't do that.
I remember seeing that, and I do remember being annoyed by it.
Because, like I said, though, it's not that the audience should be able to get out as fast as they can, because they're there to watch a fucking movie, they should stick it out till the end. But the thing is you feel, even if you're not ready to get up and leave, if you see a fade out, you kind of get a sense that this is ending.
Yeah.
So that when the movie keeps going, that makes it feel all the much longer, and it's not your fault, it's their fault for putting a fucking fade out, like, 20 minutes before it ended, when you think it could have.
True.
So, and this fucking abuses the fade out so bad.
Yeah.
Okay, I want to talk about something else that I found interesting. I don't know if the book makes this more obvious, or if it's kind of a... I don't know if I would use the word twist. No, I don't know. The movie has a narrator.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really, really unsure throughout the movie who this narrator is. Because there's... Obviously, it can't be Jeffrey Rush, because he'd sound like Jeffrey Rush. I kept thinking maybe it was the kid. It's a male narrator. But then he would talk about the kid. So it's like, okay, so it's not the kid, or he'd be saying, I. We find out... He doesn't actually come out and fucking say it. But obviously, in his dialogue towards the end, we figure out who the narrator is. And that's really interesting.
Yeah. I was like...
That's not what I was thinking.
I was like, what... I know I missed a lot of this, obviously, but what did I miss to get to us to this conclusion?
That's just...
You can't answer that, can you?
He was just a mystery narrator until he revealed himself. That's certainly an interesting way to do it.
Yeah.
That's a good thing. I condone them for that. Oh, there's one thing worth mentioning. I know this was a different time period, but I know with this, like Julianne Hough started a controversy like this, and everybody wants to make controversy out of everything, but, those people will love a scene in the middle of this movie where, there's a runner. I forgot his name now. But he has this really famous black...
Jesse Owens.
Yes.
I did see that part, too.
And the kid idolizes him. He wants to be a runner, also. Like, even when he's gonna, like, race her down the street, he does the prepping and the stretching and all that. Because he wants to be just like this guy.
Yep.
Which, of course, you know, is unheard of, because this is, you know, the 40s. But there is a point where he wants so much to be like this guy... Then he takes, I don't know if it was paint or oil or soot or what, but he basically dons blackface.
Yep.
And runs around. And he gets this, they like got him in the bathtub and they're like scrubbing it off of him and they're like giving him a stern warning. He's like, this is just not something you do. Not different words, obviously. But
yes.
Would have been great if that's what the guy actually said. This, you just don't do this.
Slaps his hand.
This is... No.
Just no. Read the script. Just ... no.
No more jazz singer for you. No more Jolson for you. So, that's pretty much the book theme.
Jeez, that was all over the place.
Well, there's not much to go because the movie didn't give me much to work with.
No, really didn't.
Alright, so that's the movies this week.
So
the book theme is actually 2 weeks late, but it's here now.
So, Homefront... is a recommendation. And Frozen...
Frozen is a recommendation. I just don't see it the way other people do.
And The Book Thief?
Nah, there's better things you could be doing. Well, I think... The people that were in there seem to take to it. I think if you're one of those book people...
Which you're becoming slowly.
not next year, obviously.
No.
I think... This movie will have a certain audience, but I don't think that audience is a very big group of people.
I don't think that this audience will keep it here very long.
This seems like something we would have watched in school.
I can see that.
So
I was thinking Athens myself, honestly. This movie does not look like something that went mainstream at all.
Alright, so that's that.
Next week I won't be here, obviously, because I leave on Wednesday. But we're going to be bringing you a limited release video. AJ, what are the movies we're going to be talking about next week?
You mean all 6 of them?
No, we're doing the 3, and then the week after, I'm going to bring that up, too.
I guess the first batch is, I I just completely drew a blank.
That's all right. No harm done. It's great when I put you on the spot. Isn't it?
It's going to be Charlie Countryman, Man of Tai Chi, and Winnie Mandela.
Okay, and that will be coming to you guys next week. And then the week after, we do have another limited release movie review of
Escape from Tomorrow, The Broken Circle Breakdown, and The Dirties.
And on top of that, we have also two verses that are going to be coming your way very soon. Those 2 weeks, we'll have two verses as well. So don't think that we're not going to be showing you AJ content while I'm gone. We're filming this all in one day, a nice marathon filming session, which is going to make AJ drop dead by the time this day's over. So, any parting words for this video, AJ?
That's it.